My name is Nikichi Taifa, Senior Policy Analyst for the Open Society Foundations, and we, along with our co-sponsoring organizations, the American Constitution Society for Law and Policy and Progress 2050 of the Center for American Progress, welcome you to what promises to be an exciting evening with a riveting conversation between author Wes Moore and NPR host Michel Martin. No, this is not Michel Martin at this moment, but shortly. And you, the audience, to be followed by a book signing and a rooftop reception. This event is webcast live, so to be sure to turn those phones off, or if you must, please place on vibrate. We welcome you to the offices of the Open Society Foundation's Washington office and to the third in our Conversations on Justice series, which is part of the Justice Roundtable, which our office convenes. I would like to recognize in advance of his coming, the director of the Washington office, Stephen Rickard, who actually is the person who first brought the story of Wes Moore to my attention over a year ago. In addition to the distinguished guest who will come in at the conclusion of the live interview between Wes and Michelle, I would also like to acknowledge the upcoming presence of Congressman Danny Davis and Congressman Bobby Scott, each of whom have been passionate advocates for the passage of legislation that would ensure that the life trajectory of events that led to the other Wes Moore serving a life sentence in prison does not become the destiny for countless other youth. So at this time, I would like to bring to the podium my colleague and friend, Caroline Fredrickson, Executive Director of the American Constitution Society for Law and Justice and Policy. I was going to say injustice, but it's all good. Who will formally introduce our interviewer and our interviewee. Thank you, Carolyn.
We'll now change our name to American Constitution Society for Law and Stuff. Law. I like law and justice. I think that's a lovely amendment. So anyway, thank you all for coming. This is going to be an extraordinary evening. We have some extraordinary speakers and people who are going to be commenting on the conversation. I'm Caroline Fredrickson, as Nikichi mentioned, Executive Director of the American Constitution Society for Law and, you know, Justice stuff. Actually, ACS for Law and Policy has been our name. And we are a national network of lawyers and judges, lawmakers, academics and law students who are dedicated to protecting our Constitution and its fundamental values, individual rights and liberties, genuine equality, access to justice, democracy, and the rule of law. And we are very pleased to join with the Open Society Foundations and Progress 2050 at the Center for American Progress in hosting Wes Moore and Michel Martin for this extremely important conversation on the other Wes Moore, One Name, Two Fates. This book has created a national platform to discuss the critical issues, including education, poverty, race, and crime. Wes Moore is a former U.S. Army captain, a Rhodes Scholar, and a White House Fellow. He currently works as an investment professional and serves as a youth advocate. He was inspired to write The Other Wes Moore after the Baltimore Sun separately reported on two young men from the Baltimore area named Wes Moore. One story focused on our Wes Moore, the Rhodes Scholar recipient. The other story focused on another Wes Moore, a man who'd been arrested for armed robbery and murder. As Wes explores in his book, and as we will consider here tonight, how could two young men from similar circumstances have lived lives that unfolded so very differently? To help us navigate this question and others, we will be joined shortly by distinguished journalist Michel Martin. Michel, for those of you who don't know her, is an Emmy Award winner and host of Tell Me More, which is an NPR one-hour news and talk show. And she's spent more than 25 years as a journalist in both print and broadcast with news outlets that include the ABC News, Washington Post, and the Wall Street Journal. But before Michel gets here, she's running a little late, we have the extraordinary privilege of having Sam Fullwood step in. Sam is a dear friend and a senior fellow at the Center for American Progress, who has focused on issues of race in America. He has an extraordinary career as a journalist, having worked at a variety of newspapers, particularly relevant to this discussion at the Baltimore Sun, but also at the LA Times and other important newspapers. So will you join me in welcoming Sam and Wes and ultimately Michelle?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Carolyn, and thank you, Nikichi. I am not Michelle, and when she gets here, I'll have some choice words for her. But in the meantime, I can't tell you how elated I am to have this opportunity to have a conversation with Wes. I had hoped that it would be just one-on-one, but now we're going to have this conversation in front of a whole room full of people. Having sort of followed a little bit about your career, I know the great success that the book has had so far. And I want to start, before we get to the book, to learn a little bit about your story, because that sort of is the preamble to how the whole other Wes Moore story unfolded. You grew up in Baltimore?
Yes, and first, Sam, thank you so much. And not only as a person who knows Baltimore, but also as a proud fraternity brother. it's great to be with you, and also for OSF, for CAP, for ACS. You know, thank you so much for this invitation. It's really humbling on a lot of levels. And I actually spent my childhood in a few different places.
That's what I wanted to start with. You're telling me a little bit about how you grew up in Baltimore.
So initially we actually lived down in Maryland until I was about. And my mom is sitting here in the front row, so she can just nod her head. So there's my mom. Thank you. So we lived down in Maryland until I was about 5 years old. When I was 3 and a half, my father passed away, and it was really difficult as I thought it was on me, because at 3 and a half years old, you don't realize what really happened, right? I mean, people tell you that he passed away, and you really have no idea what that even means. And it doesn't really hit until you get older, when you realize that he's not coming back. But the person who really had it toughest was my mother. And so after spending a couple years still down in Maryland, after he passed away, my mother realized that she needed some help. And so she called up my grandparents.
Were you an only child?
No, sorry. I had an older sister who was 6 years older than me, and a younger sister who was a year and a half younger. So I was a middle kid, and the only boy. Yeah, check that out. But when I was about 5 years old, we moved up to New York and moved up to the Bronx, where I was living with our grandparents. And it was interesting because, you know, our grandparents weren't really expecting us to go back up there at any point. I mean, they had a small home in the Bronx, and you know, my grandfather was a minister, my grandmother was a school teacher, both of them had just retired, so they expected that was going to be, you know, kind of their retire now. And then they get a call from my mom, who says, you know, I can't do this on my own anymore. And then all four of us, you know, their house was barely big enough for them, but they figured out a way to make it big enough for all of us. And then we took that ride up 95 and ended up in the Bronx. So I spent some time up in the Bronx until I was 13 or 14, and then we moved back down after that.
Okay. What was it like when you came back to Baltimore? What was Baltimore like at that time?
You know,
when was that? What year was that?
That was in 1992. And it was interesting because when we first moved back, I was actually at that point, backstory, I had some issues coming up, and I was actually sent to military school, which is a whole other issue. So I was actually in military school when mom had moved back down. And so even though I spent part of the school year up in Pennsylvania at this military school, the family we were still down in Maryland. Baltimore was and is a fascinating city, because the thing I love about Baltimore is
The Wire.
Yeah. Let me tell you. So I know there are a lot of folks in Baltimore who Baltimore for non-Baltimore folks.
Baltimore.
A lot of folks in Baltimore who actually have a lot of issues, and I completely understand that, because Baltimore isn't just The Wire. But to talk about Baltimore without understanding that The Wire is reality for a lot of kids is unfair as well. Because fact is, you know, if you walk down around the Inner Harbor, you walk up around Guilford, you go up around Hopkins, that people look at it like, this is where The Wire is? But then if you walk around West Baltimore and you go around Dolphin Street, and people are like, okay, I see it now. I get it. And the reality of this juxtaposition between, you know, between kids, between neighborhoods, between communities is very real in a city like Baltimore.
So did you live a wire existence in 92 in Baltimore?
No, I mean, what was interesting was that as we were coming up, and particularly once I'd moved back down afterwards I finished high school, it wasn't necessarily a wire existence. It wasn't necessarily where you have dilapidated housing surrounding you or anything like that. But the reality of Baltimore is this, is that what goes on this block can be very different what goes on. I mean, you know Baltimore. So what goes on this block could be very different what's going on in this block. And the thing about the neighborhoods that I was living in is that it was impossible to separate yourself from everything. I was not, even when I moved back and went to school back in Baltimore, when I went to Johns Hopkins, I was not a living on campus kind of guy. I mean, I was not I take shuttles everywhere. I mean, I like Baltimore. I love Baltimore. One of the big reasons why I chose Hopkins instead of a lot of other places was because of the fact, for me, it was going home. For me, it was about the fact that, you know, yeah, it was, you know, a good school and everything, but this was a chance for me to go back home. And so I never had a desire to be the on-campus kid. I wanted to go back to the Baltimore I knew, which was great. And eye-opening, because you see the changes that are happening, you see, you know, everything, the way it's evolving. But again, it's impossible to separate yourself from the reality of it.
So you went to Johns Hopkins. How many of your friends from the hood went to Johns Hopkins with you?
Quite honestly, at that point, there were zero kids that I knew. Now, one thing about Hopkins, which has been good, and I'm actually really proud of Hopkins for this, Hopkins has a new program called Baltimore Scholars. And basically what Baltimore Scholars is Hopkins has raised an endowment. So where if you graduate from the public school system in Baltimore City, any public school in Baltimore City, and you get accepted to Johns Hopkins University, they will pay for you to go to school. So we've got kids from City, kids from Poly, kids from Baltimore School of the Arts, kids from Western, wherever. If you get accepted to Johns Hopkins University, you don't have a single bill.
So I guess where I was going with my question was, how did you decide to go to Hopkins?
Yeah.
What got you from the neighborhood to Hopkins? Military school.
Well, it's military school was helpful, but one thing I'm very clear about when I speak to people, I don't think the answer to fixing schools in our country is picking kids up from one school and just sending them to another school. Mm-hmm. And I've seen this firsthand, that if the services and support aren't in place to assist with that transition, it actually compounds the problem. So I don't think the answer is, okay, this is a bad community, take a kid from that community and throw them into another community, and then all is well. It's not as effective as people want to make it out to be. It's definitely not cost effective. And what you end up doing is then basically, you know, picking and choosing which kids are quote unquote saved. And that's not fair. I mean, the best way that you help a child is by making sure they come up in a strong, supportive home. The best way you help that home is to make sure that home exists in a strong, supportive community. And the best way you help that community is by making sure there's strong anchor educational institutions inside the community that can actually help with that transition. One thing we saw with Hopkins, and quite honestly, even I go back to the Baltimore Scholars Program we're talking about, one of the challenges that Hopkins is having, even with this program, and we could talk about this conversation about educational equality, is right now for the Baltimore Scholars Program, there are about 4 to 5 schools in all of Baltimore City that every single Baltimore scholar is picked from. Now, that's not because Hopkins is picking and choosing which schools they want to pick. That's because these are the schools that are preparing kids, that Hopkins feels that kids are coming out of there prepared for Hopkins curriculum. And so that question needs to be addressed as well, because it's a fantastic program. But when you have 5 schools in the city that are sending kids to this program, that is a larger issue that needs to be addressed.
So I want to circle back to you again. So were you sort of empowered from your home to prepare you to be able to go to Hopkins? That's the question I'm really getting at.
Yes. I think it
took... Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I think it took a little while for me to figure it out, though. Just to be quite honest. I think I'm not just saying it because she's in the room. But I had a person in my mother who is not just one of the most remarkable people, one of the most remarkable leaders I know. And my mother always told me, when we were coming up, she would say, you know, I never gave birth to you because I needed another friend. I mean, she was very clear. No, I'm not trying to be funny, but she was very clear that she's like, you know, you don't need another friend. That's your problem. You're surrounding you're trying to follow a whole lot of people that you think are your friends. And then, you know, I'll do this and I'm trying to entertain them and I'm trying to make them laugh or whatever. And then I get in trouble and I turn around and they're nowhere to be found. And she's trying to explain to me, that's not friendship. These people are using you. Mm-hmm. And so, but I think it really did take me a while to fully appreciate what she was trying to give me. And a lot of it was because as much as parents or even as much as you know, the people inside the home can try to help, the people who I was really looking for that acceptance were my peers.
Yes.
And the problem is a lot of times my peers didn't have my best interests at heart. And so I'm sitting there looking for acceptance from a whole lot of people who could care less about where I ended up. And then therefore that always led to a lot of the actions that I had. What I think then happened though, at military school, and again, I'm not at all saying that military school is the answer. You know what I'm saying? But I am saying this. I remember the first time that I actually saw a different example of something. It was the first days of military school, I'd run away. In the first 4 days, I'd run away 5 times. I mean, I literally kept on trying to run away from the school. Now, I wish I was kidding, I'm not. I just kept trying to run away from the school. And after the last time I ran away, it was 1 o'clock in the morning, and I'm sitting in the chair, and my chain of command, the student leadership, was behind me. And they were standing to my left and standing to my right. And I looked over my left shoulder, and I'm looking at him just with this ice grill, just kneeling down, like, stop looking at me, you know? And then I look over to my right, and I look over, and I see the people, and then I saw one guy who was standing right here. He was an African-American guy, probably like 5'10", 230 pounds. And he was a type of, he was like 230 with no neck, just like this. like all muscle, seriously, all muscle. And so I look back at him, and I look forward, and because he scared me, so I didn't want to look back at him again. So I just kept looking forward. But he never said a word to me. Next day, I see him with my TAC officer, a guy named Colonel Battaglioli, and they're talking and they're pointing at me, and I'm supposed to be standing attention in formation, saying I'm standing attention, but I'm looking at him in the corner of my eye, noticing that he's still looking at me. Finally, he walks away from Colonel Battaglioli, he salutes, and Colonel Battaglioli salutes him back, and he starts walking towards his company, which is F Company, which is the older cadets. And so I assumed that he would just kind of fall into formation and fall into the back of formation. He starts walking up in front of the formation. And as he walked up, someone in the company yelled, "Company Tench, hoot!" And then all 150 cadets at the same time just crack and all snapped to attention. And he just kept walking. And he walked to the front of the company. And then the person who I thought was in charge saluted him. And he saluted him back. And the person who I thought was in charge fell into formation. And I remember thinking to myself as I was watching this out of the corner of my eye, I was like, that dude is in charge. Like, that was amazing to me. I had never seen anything like that. Like, that kind of respect, that kind of, I mean, dude didn't say nothing. He just walked in front of them, and they all snapped to attention. And it was funny because the respect that I had for a lot of my peers who I was coming up with, the fear, intimidation, they were bigger than everybody. They were cool than everybody. They got all the girls. They got this. They got that. All of a sudden, as soon as that crack happened and he walked in front of that company, they got real small real quick. And all of a sudden, that started to become the model of what I was trying. Because I was like, that's what I want. That's the kind of acknowledgement. That's real respect. And I think, so that's really what started to happen, was that transition of what it is that you want to be started happening. And then you say, again, you know, when you have a target, you start moving towards that target and doing things that target sees. I mean, one thing they told us in the military was that, you know, you can't hit a target you can't see. And so I started to actually have a better idea of what kind of target I was shooting for.
I'm going to pause here. I understand that Michelle is coming to the room, so I'm going to sit down as the second string and let the first team come in.
Let's get Sam a big hand. Talk about Plan B. Woo, 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 woo. And now we have the fabulous Michel Martin. You know, it's one thing with co-sponsoring organizations. We co-sponsor with CAP and ACS. Well, Michel, I understand you went to CAP. So go on and take it away, Michel. Let's give Michel Martin a big hand.
Hello, how are you?
Hi, Michelle, how are you?
Hello, great. How are you? Sorry I was late. Well, picking up where we left off, you know, I was thinking that when I went away to school, not in quite as dramatic circumstances as you did, but there was a moment when I walked outside by myself at 10 o'clock at night and looked up at the stars. And I realized that as a, you know, 14-year-old girl at that time, 13, 14-year-old girl from Brooklyn, from a certain kind of neighborhood in Brooklyn where if you were a loved child, you didn't go outside by yourself at night, right? You know what I'm talking about? That I realized my life was different and it was never going to be what it was before. So I wanted to ask you, what was that moment for you when you realized your life was different and it was never going to be what it was before?
You know, that there's one time, and I was thinking about it, and actually it was funny because one of the things about the process of this book, it forced me to think about my life in a way I hadn't thought about it before, and to be introspective in a way that I'd never been introspective before. I remember one time when I was back home, and I was pretty mischievous, and I liked a lot of activity, and I got into, you know, scuffles at times with people, whatever. And but I got into a little altercation with some buddies of mine from home. This is when I was kind of off on leave or whatever from military school. And we got no fight. And basically, the fight was kind of the whole, oh, you've changed, you this, you that, that kind of thing, because you go away and then you come back. And then I remember going to see my uncle, my mom's brother, Uncle Howard. And he asked me what happened. And I told him I just got into a fight and, you know, told him that, you know, that basically this is the background, that's what happened. And he said something to me that was really interesting. He said, it's not that you've changed. It's that they haven't. And I felt like I kind of understood what he was saying then, but it really took me getting a little older to realize exactly what he was saying, was that the thing that was most intimidating to them wasn't the fact that I have changed, but was the fact when they looked at me and they saw this level of progression, this level of this manhood journey taking shape, and the fact that things hadn't in their lives, I think that became very intimidating and very frustrating to them as well. And so I think part of the thing that happened to me when I really started noticing that things were really different was as I got back home and I saw that I looked at things differently. I approached things differently. My decision-making process was different. I wasn't as impulsive. I wasn't as thoughtless as I had been before, and that's when I started noticing that, you know, this is a different phase that I've entered into. Still wasn't quite sure fully what it was, but I noticed this was a definitely different phase for me.
In the movie version of your life, and I assume there will be a movie, don't forget me for the cameo. In that version, I'll be on time. but in the movie version of your. You didn't answer that, by the way. Is there a movie for in the works? Oprah Winfrey Studios, Harpo?
Wow. Well, she's a great journalist, ain't she? So Harpo and HBO Films have actually optioned the rights.
That's what we figured, yeah. Okay. So in the movie version, there will be the newspaper will fall open on the very day that the article appears about you getting your Rhodes Scholarship and going to Oxford. And on the very day, and probably on the jump, you know, there will be the other story about the other Wes Moore. And it'll be on the same paper in the same day. But that's not really how it happened in real life.
That's not how it happened. Okay. It's funny because they did happen around the same time, but there is no single paper that had, you know, because fact is, and because the truth is that they wrote about Wes's life and the story and everything like that and the tragedy of Sergeant Prothero's death. They, you know, there were literally, you know, 200 articles written about this. There was one article written on one day about me receiving the
report. Sure, I get you. No, I get you. But where I was going with this is I wanted to ask, so what was it that grabbed you? What was it that said to you, I have to know about this brother? I have to know about him.
Well, I mean, initially, the first time I even really heard his name was from Mom, who was saying that, you know, there are wanted posters in your neighborhood. And the wanted posters said the police are looking for Wes Moore, da da da. And so that forced me to even think about this story even more. Because fact is, and, you know, I remember someone asked me, they said, if you guys didn't have the same name, would you ever reach out to him? I said, fact is, if we didn't have the same name, I wouldn't even known. I would have read it and I would have done what I know all of us do. Sometimes you look at a story and say, "Wow, that's a tragedy," and then we go about our lives.
That's a damn shame.
That's right, exactly.
That's a damn shame.
And then we go about our lives. So, once I heard about, you know, the fact that he had the same name was the first thing. Then I started reading these other articles, and saw the fact that we were living in the same area. I learned about the fact that we were around the same age. We both grew up in single-parent households. We both had academic and disciplinary troubles growing up. And that's, so the more I read, the more I'm like, this is crazy. And that's when I really started thinking, so how does this happen then? How do you get two kids that are from similar backgrounds, similar circumstances, but then as I'm getting ready to head 3,000 miles away from home to go on a scholarship, he's getting ready to head 25 miles away from home to a maximum security facility. And what does that mean to all of us? And so it was something that I couldn't really let go. And quite honestly, I remember when I first started talking about even reaching out to him. I mean, there were some very real conversations and debates even, you know, within family that was like, why do you need to reach out to him? Like, what is the point of this? You know, why are you giving him your address? Why? I mean, so very real concerns that people had. No, I mean, I'm just being real. But I knew that, you know, I can't control what he does, but I can control what I do. And if this kept on eating, if this was like, you know, something that was I wanted to explore, then that's what I said I wanted to explore. And that's when I first decided to actually write him. And then it was a month later when I received a letter back from Jessup Correctional Institution from him. And that's how the whole journey began.
You say several times in the book that you just aren't sure why. You really aren't sure why. But I am going to ask you to speculate, first for you and then for him. And that's why I ask you the first question about what was that moment when you knew I'm not going back? I have a choice to go this way. And you know it firmly that you have that choice. And then I'm asking you, what do you think that moment was for him? Because one of the things I think will be a revelation to people is how hard he did try. I mean, he really did try.
He did. And I tell you, Michelle, and I'm really glad you said that, because fact is, for most people in Wes's situation, for most people who are in prison, we're talking lifers. Most people don't really care too much about their story. Most people have no concern or curiosity or anything about how they got there. And part of the frustration for me is, you know, a lot of the work and a lot of my passions actually deal with both the issue of education, also the issue of criminal, particularly juvenile justice. Because I think what happens for so many kids, unfortunately, once you get caught up in that revolving door of that system, which, you know, fact is, you're talking about, and we're talking about 70%, we have a 70% recidivism rate inside this country right now. Once you get caught up in that door, most people don't seem to care a whole lot about if that revolving door ever really ends. And the thing that frustrated me was, I was like, if we don't actually take time and actually consider what's going on, if we're not willing to actually look at these lives and actually, you know, peel them apart, both positive and negative, we're just doomed to keep on repeating these same mistakes and never learn anything from them. So it's interesting, because Wes really did try on a lot of levels, and Wes is not a dumb guy by any stretch of the imagination. One thing I try to highlight in the book is the fact that Wes is actually a very intelligent guy who's made some bad decisions, but he's actually a very smart guy. One thing that I think that happened with him was at different turning points where he thought that he was out of the woods, where he thought that he had made a decision that could really change things around, he was just continually met with elements and obstacles that he could not, that he just didn't have the wherewithal to kind of navigate.
Like what? Was it the early pregnancy, being a father at what, 17, and then not being able
first
to
at 15.
For 15 and not being able to earn enough to support
Definitely one of them. You know, my wife and I just had a baby a month ago.
Congratulations. See, that is a man. Bury the lead, right? You know, you and I, we'd be all like, "Whoa, my baby over here." Congratulations.
No, thank you. And I mean, we are blessed by this little girl that we just welcomed in. And I'm thinking to myself, I've got a wonderful wife. She's got this, our baby's got two wonderful grandmothers. She's got aunts, she's got uncles, she got herself. And I'm still scared to death about the fact that this is a real responsibility. It's like she needs us more than anything else in the whole world. Well, she needs my wife more. But I mean, I'm helpful too, right?
We'll check with her on that.
But I think to myself, what it's like for that 15-year-old who's going to do it on her own. What it's like for that 17-year-old who's a high school senior who is on her way to college and then misses her period and realize she's about to have a child. And so you realize just how difficult this transition is. So I think that was one. I think another real turning point for Wes also was when he left the Job Corps. Wes, for people who aren't familiar with the Job Corps is actually a really extraordinary program. You know, everyone from high school dropouts, people involved in the juvenile justice system, basic work to give them skills and training, and then try to place them inside of jobs. Wes, after he left high school, which was another turning point when you decide that high school isn't for me, we see what happens. You know, fact is, if you are a high school dropout in Baltimore City, you have a better chance of making a life in jail than making a life in with a full-time employment, period. But when he goes on to Job Corps, he gets his GED in Job Corps. He takes a reading. He finds out that he's reading at a sophomore in college reading level. Again, going back to the fact that I'm like, this is no dummy. Comes out of Job Corps and realizes that people, when you have a felony record, people aren't that quick to hire you. And so he ends up working multiple different odd jobs. At this point now, he's got four children.
By several women.
By two different women.
All of whom are asking for support.
That's exactly right. The mothers of the children are asking for support. His mother's helping to raise some of the kids. So she's asking for support. He's got to take care of himself. And by the way, he's making $6.60 an hour. And he then goes back, and Wes, again, these are decisions that he made. But Wes says, you know I can make thousands of dollars a day. I know how to do that. I did that before. And he makes a decision that, as he even says now, was, you know, arguably one of the worst decisions that he's ever made in his life, that he makes a decision to go back to the streets because he's like, I know where I can easily make money. I know what I can do. I know how the pattern works. And I've been doing that ever since I was, before my teenage years. And so that was where, those barriers and obstacles he wasn't able to navigate ended up leading him right back to where he went.
In contrast to you, and then we are going to open it up because I know everybody wants to participate in the conversation, and I think we would welcome participation whether you read the book or not, because I'm sure some people have read it, some people haven't, but we'd love to hear from you. And also that we've got a great panel of invited commenters who want to chip in first. So we're going to come to the, I didn't mean that, you know, colloquial chip in. I realize in the context of what we were just talking about wasn't really the right turn of phrase. See, some of you knew what I was talking about, and some of you didn't. I was noticing who laughed. But for you, one of the things that I was noting was that you ran away from school four times in the first, what?
Four times, first 4 days, and then I ran away another time.
And another four times in the first 4 days, and you ran away another time after that, and you hated it there, and I felt for you, but you had not only your mother, but other men in the community and your peers who linked arms around you to tell you what?
First tell me you're
get
not-
Get your ass back to bed, yeah, but other than that-
First tell me you're not going anywhere, so you might as well go back, and I realize that this running away thing ain't working. But who helped me to understand this idea of belonging, and who helped me understand this idea of responsibility. Like, you know, I started realizing the only way that I could make it was if my plea brothers were there pushing me. And the only way that they can make it was if I was there pushing them. And so I started to better understand my role in all this. So, you know, for example, I mean, one of the things I think that are really important for not just all kids, but particularly for young boys, is this concept of leadership. And what I mean by that is this, young boys in particular, they are type A personalities. I mean, we want to be in charge of something. We want to have some kind of responsibility. And fact is, when you look at what happened between both boys, you had two boys who were both looking for that sense of belonging and responsibility at very similar times in our life. And both actually looking at it to take it in positive directions and help us to help with our life. And then one kid got it and the other kid didn't. But what the training that I got was really no different than the training that Wes got, when you really think about it. I mean, fact is, when you look at what happened to me in military school, when you start off military school, you'll start off as they'll say, okay, Moore, you're in charge of this corridor. Your job is to make sure the corridor is clean. And if the hallway is clean, then we're going to congratulate you. And if the hallway is dirty, we're going to come after you. And so I started taking that seriously. I see a person throwing out Doritos, and
right.
I'm picking up. I'm like, yo, pick up that bag of Doritos. This is my corridor. And then from there, I became a squad leader, and they said, okay, you're in charge of these three people. And if Michelle, if you show up late to school, the question the teacher's asking you isn't necessarily why you're late for school. The question the teacher's asking you is, who's your squad leader? And they're going to find me. And they're going to come to me, and they're going to say, Michelle's late for school. Why? And I need to have an answer. And so you see that, and then you come platoon sergeant, whatever. So you see that graduated sense of responsibility. Well, Wes Scott is no different. Because when you look at the structure of the drug operation in Baltimore or any other city, kids don't start off as kingpins, right? We start off as lookouts. We're the ones who stand outside, and when you see a car roll by or you see someone who doesn't look familiar come by, your job is to yell out, Susan or Rhonda. What they're doing is they're tipping people off.
So was, I guess, the critical piece, and then we're going to turn to the folks here. Do you think the critical piece was the opportunity to lead or the group?
It was the opportunity to lead, but also a real structured and positive understanding of where are you trying to lead people to. It was giving an understanding and giving an actual vision as to where you'd hope to be, and then people there trying to show you what are those steps needed in order to get there. That sense of belonging is going to happen for kids. Kids are going to find that sense of belonging. The question always becomes, who's teaching them that sense of belonging, and who are they hoping to gain that sense of belonging from? Because again, you know, fact is, both Wes and I got that sense of belonging. But I think the people that we chose to lead us in that, and the people that chose to step in and lead us, were just had very different agendas.
And you also note in the book that Wes has become a leader in Jessup of the Muslim community there. He's converted to Islam. Is he still practicing?
He is. He's
become kind of a spiritual leader.
He has. He's become a spiritual leader. And I tell you, the thing about Wes, and it's important for people to remember too about him, is, you know, Wes understands his fate. Wes understands that, you know, that he will spend the rest of his life in prison. But Wes is still doing what he can do, is trying to do what he can do now to actually make an impact, particularly on the shorties, the ones who are coming out of prison. Because fact is, 100% of juveniles in the juvenile justice system and 95% of people in the adult prison system are coming out. They're coming out. How we prepare them for their reentry and how we prepare society for their reentry becomes a very big deal. And one thing that Wes is actually really trying to do is particularly show the ones who are coming out, who have shorter bids, letting them know, you know, that's an opportunity that I wish I had. Take advantage of it. And here are some things, hopefully, that you can do that can better help you. Because fact is, I mean, the amount of intellectual wasteland in many cases that is our juvenile and criminal justice systems in this country is astonishing, especially when you consider how much money we are putting into the system that is fundamentally broken. A 70% recidivism rate basically means we have only 30% of the time that the system actually works. If I had anything that worked 30%, if my BlackBerry worked 30% of the time, I'm calling somebody up.
It depends on what it's working to do. You know what I mean?
And I say this, you know, when you look at the intent, and I think the adult prison system, and I want to be very clear, there are people who have committed crimes that justify them being separated from society. I totally understand that. But I do believe this. When you look at the fact that the majority of people inside of our prison systems are there for nonviolent offenses and for things like parole violations, there needs to be a real conversation about how this actually worked and what the larger intent of this is. In addition to that, when you look at the juvenile justice system, the stated intent of the juvenile justice system in this country is reformation. How many juvenile justice systems in this country can actually attest that they are about the reformation of their young people? Or has it simply just become a pipeline to an adult system? And so that's what I mean by that.
Okay. Let's start opening the conversation up. Why don't we, Paul, do you want to start? You want to start with Cheryl? We're going to start. Cheryl, do you want to start? All right. Well, just let me introduce you. Cheryl Cashin is professor of law at Georgetown University at Law Center. She's author of The Agitator's Daughter, a memoir of four generations of one extraordinary African-American family. Professor Cashin, question or comment?
Yeah, I have a quick comment. And Wes, first of all, thank you for writing this book. And I'm going to tell you that although you seem like the hero of the book, the true heroine of the book is your mama. And I have to say, I really, really admire you. And that speaks to my comment. You speak several times, you said in your comments and your book suggested that there were not really many differences in your experience between you and the other West. And I would argue with you on that. I think there was one big difference. I think you, and I think this is true with a lot of high achieving African Americans, had a cultural legacy that the other Wes Moore did not. You know, you came out of this striving immigrant Jamaican tradition, and you know, in my own book I talk about this, where, you know, I'm a third generation valedictorian. I received this cultural inheritance, this idea that Cashins never get up, they work and they work and work, and when you resisted it when you were a knucklehead, right? But you had a mother who had that, you know, that striving culture. She was not going to let you fail. My favorite scene in the book is when she slapped you not once but twice. You know, this woman was not going to let you fail.
That
you
was
know?
My favorite scene.
I can't wait to see it in the movie. She's, you know, but the sad.
Or for Viola Davis or Alfre Woodard. Viola, Alfre. for Viola.
Obviously, and I'll be quick because there are other people coming. The sad and tragic thing is that so many African American kids, you know, 2/3 of them are born out of wedlock. Are the culture that they're growing up with, a lot of them is this culture of the street. So they asked us in our comments to try to be forward thinking and talk about solutions. So I would say I was asked to speak about culture and family, but I there are two things I want to say. One, a caveat. You cannot deny the structural inequalities that make parenting really hard. I feel for Mary. She really, really tried, and she was crushed by the weight of the structural inequalities. Somebody else is speaking to that. Society has to address those things. We can't ignore them. Culture alone isn't going to make a difference. But I do think it is very important for institutions to teach these cultural values to the extent that families can't. If I were queen for the day, I would ask every black church in America to have the kind of program that my church, 19th Street Baptist, has. They have a manhooded training program where they are doing for families, you know, what families in functional families do, imparting these values and not giving up on kids.
Did Mary go to church?
Yes, she did. And thank you so much. And she did go to church. And what was interesting was that Wes, faith comes up a lot when Wes and I talk, because he says that it really wasn't until he went to prison that he really found a full connection with faith. He talked about how, you know, he used to go to church and just chalk up everything to theatrics when he see people passing out in the aisles and he see people, you know, jumping up and down and screaming. And he said, I kept on wondering myself, what God are they praying to when you have kids who are growing up, you know, without any parents, so kids who have a father in prison, and they come back home and their mother's strung out, what God are they praying to? Because I don't, as you know, there's one scene in the book when Wes is actually getting a tattoo, and he says, you know, God, because even if he does exist, he sure doesn't come around West Baltimore. And so I think that was there was a frustration that I know he had with faith, but I think there's another thing about Mary, which I think is a really important point that you brought up as well. You know, Mary was the first one in her family to go to college. You know, Mary graduated from Baltimore City Community College with honors, gets accepted at Johns Hopkins University, and is at Johns Hopkins University and figures out and gets a note one day saying that her Pell Grants were cut. And she knew she could no longer afford to go to school. And I can't help but think how different Mary's life could have been had she had the chance to finish college. And it's not just because of the piece of paper. It's not just because of the thing we can frame and put up on our walls. It's because with education, and particularly higher education, your networks change, your friendships change, your connections change. I've said before, if I took a quick straw poll, and I'd be the first one to raise my hand for either the job that you have now or the job you've had in recent history, how many of you did not get that job by classified ads or monster.com? Because 70% of the jobs in this country don't happen that way. 70% of jobs in this country happen from one day you receive an email from somebody who says, you know what, we have a mutual friend, I'm looking for someone that can do X, Y, and Z, they recommended you, would you have some time to talk? Or you contact a friend and say, I'm really interested in getting into this field, do you know anybody that does that? And they say, I know 3 people that do that. Here, let me put you in touch with them. And then that's how the ball rolls. And so the importance of Mary in this story, and quite honestly, and I have a tremendous amount of respect for Mary, despite everything, because she would never, I mean, when she looked at her two babies, does anyone honestly believe that she looked at those two babies and thought that, you know, one day I'd have to go visit them in prison for life to see them anymore? She fought so hard to help out her kids navigate, but there were significant pressure that she had to, that she was fighting against.
Do you guys have an order, or do you just go around? Okay, so why don't we just go back and forth? Paul, do you want to go, or you still doing your homework? That's okay. Shall we skip you, and then we'll go to... Okay, Mr. Hewitt, would you like to... Now, you were here on time, and you still not ready to...
Professor Butler is always on time.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Wait a minute. Damon Hewitt is director of the education practice at the NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund. Mr. Hewitt, you had a question or a comment.
Thank you so much, Michelle. I'm struck... by, in the book and also themes that Wes picked up tonight, these kind of contradictory but connected notions of being simultaneously an anomaly, but also a simile of the other Wes Moore. And I guess to him, you're the other Wes Moore. in many respects, right? So there, how the paths, how did they diverge? How did things end up differently for you? Part of it, I imagine, are decision points, which you talk about in a very pointed way in your life and also in Wes's life as well. But there's also structural barriers, which I hope people leave the book understanding the structural barriers, the voids of opportunity, and these portholes of opportunity that both you and Wes had. You may have had more, but you may have been able to take advantage of them to a greater degree. But when I think about these structural barriers, I think about the stigma of education and inequity and lack of access. And, you know, it's been said that prison is society's response to poverty. It's how we deal with poor people. Well, how do we deal with educational inequity? How do we deal with educational failure? It's often through an exclusion of a different type, suspension, expulsion, and even arrest in school, otherwise known as the school-to-prison pipeline. Now, at the same time, over the last 35 or so years, when the U.S. prison population has grown exponentially, the number of suspensions and expulsions has also doubled in this country at the very same time. I don't think those things are by accident. So one of the things that got you through, Wes, and you're right about this, is, and you talked about it tonight, connectedness, sense of belonging. But when children are, when they suffer educational disparities, when they suffer inequities, don't have access to high-quality education where they are or anywhere, they end up being disconnected. And when the system suspends, expels, and arrests them for nonviolent behavior, because that rise in mass incarceration, mostly nonviolent, also the suspensions, expulsions, nonviolent. Not weapons, drugs, and guns, but talking back, but disrespect, but not being able to fit in and conform. So what do you see as a prescription in terms of educational institutions, in terms of educational reform, as it were, how we can address this school-to-prison pipeline to make sure we don't send kids on that path through that revolving door, to make sure we keep them connected?
Great question. Great question by a great alpha man. There's a few things. First I'll say a couple quick points about the juvenile justice system in particular, then specifically about education reform. On the juvenile justice system, first, it's fascinating. If you look at, there's certain people that, and I want to be very clear, certain people who actually have done juvenile justice right. And they've actually figured out a way of coming up with juvenile justice models that can actually make sense, that actually talk about reformation and talk about not creating pipelines. You look at what happens in Missouri, the Missouri model, as an example of a juvenile justice system, where instead of, you know, bars and basically almost making it just look like a baby booking, like a smaller version of a larger adult system, which again, we talk about what is it that we see when in terms of what we want to become. Missouri's actually broken it down to more regional models of juvenile justice system. In addition to that, they've focused more on things like educational attainment. What happens for far too many kids is when they enter into the juvenile justice system, they end up going directly into special needs classes, which for many of these kids is the last thing that they actually need. But this is where they're placed so as not to disturb the rest of the kids. And so how we think about juvenile justice in this country, I think, becomes very real, particularly when you consider the fact that 67% of people in the adult prison system have juvenile records. So basically all we have now is kids who are now getting older and committing more serious crimes. How we also think about education reform in this country is, I think, incredibly important. I think the ed reform conversation and debate we're having in this country is an incredibly important one. The whole debate about what are we doing to help out public schools, what role does charters and magnets and all this kind of stuff play, those are all very important conversations. But I also know this. When you look at the three leading indicators that help to determine if a child is going to be reading at grade level by the end of third grade, which is also one of the first primary levels that we look at, because there are states, Maryland included, but there are states that literally where government leaders, governors, will look at third grade reading scores to determine how many beds will be needed later on. And if you ask them why, you say that's inhumane, that's crazy, they say it might be crazy, but there's also direct correlation, right? End of third grade reading scores. If you look at the factors, the main factors that lead to a child not reading by grade level by the end of third grade, three things come up. One is chronic absence. Kids are defined as not going to school 30% or more, just not showing up. So if you're not in the building, you can't learn, right? The second one is summer learning loss. So basically, if during the summer, if you're going off to museums and you're going to Paris with your family or you're going to wherever, I mean, your brain is still being stimulated during those months. For far too many children, their summertime activity includes things like playing in fire hydrants. If that's the case, it will take you until November to catch up to where you left off in June. The third thing is kids who are entering school unprepared. If you talk to most teachers, kindergarten teachers, first grade teachers, and you ask them, what is it that you need? If I could give you anything, more resources, pens, whatever, what would really help you do your job? The vast majority of them have said to me, there's one thing that I would love to have, and that is a classroom full of kids ready to learn, because that would allow me to do my job. The problem is that we've got these kids over here that are ready to go, and these kids that are here that are not. So if I teach too fast, I completely lose the kids that are unprepared. If I teach too slow, I completely bore the kids that are. And so it's a no-win for me as an instructor, no-win as a teacher. And so how we think about not just what happens inside the classroom, but what are we doing to prepare kids to enter the classroom, and what happens during those crucial months where they might not necessarily be inside the classroom is, I think, a key component to it as well. How we address that, and I apologize. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm a nerd, so I like really like, but so it's like.
You got a room full. So
yes.
Right.
So real quick. So how we address parents, how we get parents as part of that conversation as well, helping them understand that they're their child's first and best teachers. How we allow community organizations, like you're talking about with the churches, et cetera, to be a part of that conversation, I think is very important as well. I can go into more detail, but I will shut up.
Congressman Scott, I'm going to let you get settled for a minute. Do you want to get settled for a minute? You had a big day. Congratulations. That's okay. Nicole Austin Hillary is the director and counsel of the Brennan Center's Washington, D.C. office. You had a question or a comment?
I have a little of both, Michelle, and I'll be quick because I don't want you to, because you know I will.
I know you will, Michelle. First of all, thank you so much for allowing me to be here today. And I have to say, Wes, you know, I'm listening to you and I feel like I'm living vicariously through you, because like you, and as Michelle talked about her community, and I'm proud to say this, I'm a project kid, and I'm very proud to hear about people who come from varying communities and are able to quote unquote make it. But there's two things that I want to talk about, and I'd love to hear your comments on it. One is racial disparities, and you talked about this a little bit. One of the things that I focus on at the Brennan Center is dealing with the issue of racial disparities in the criminal justice system. We work closely with many people in this room, Congressman Scott, on this issue, and trying to figure out what do we do to ensure that we are getting prosecutors and other folks in the criminal justice system to look at people based on what they are bringing to the table and not looking at them based on their race. And we know that racial disparities deal with every aspect of the criminal justice system, from charges to sentencing to whatnot. So I'd love to hear any thoughts that you have about ways that we as a social justice advocacy community can try to deal with racial disparities, and what we can be doing to try to combat those and work within the system and work with DOJ and prosecutors around the country to combat that. And then secondly, leadership. You talked a lot about leadership. One of the things that I'd love to hear you also comment on is the obligation that we, as particularly African American professionals, those of us who have had educational advantages, other social advantages, what is the obligation that we have, and what are things that we should be doing to try to reach into our communities and bridge the gap that exists between those of us who have had more opportunities versus those who have had lesser? Because that's really the example that you set in the book and in the life that you've lived with respect to your relationship to the other Wes Moore. I think more of that needs to be done, but I think there is a division. You know, Eugene Robinson has written about that, and the fact that, you know, we have varying communities now of African Americans. Some of us who have made it seem to relate more to, you know, individuals from other communities who have made it. So what is it that we need to be doing to help bridge that gap, and what is it that we need to be doing to try to deal with this issue of racial disparities?
Thank you very much. Both great questions, and I'll be brief, I promise. First thing, you know, what's interesting, and I'll tell a very, very, very quick anecdote. I remember once doing a police ride-along in Baltimore City, and I have an extraordinary amount of respect for people in law enforcement, particularly because, again, these are folks who go to work every day, in many ways very almost fatalistic, because they have no idea what's going to happen during the remainder of that day. And the fact that we all can breathe easy in many cases is because we have people who are willing to stand up and defend. So I have a tremendous amount of respect for them. I remember doing a police ride-along in Baltimore once. And this was when I was a senior in college. And they got a report in that there were guys, you know, smoking out in the back alley or whatever. We went into the back alley, you know, whoop, when cops come up, curl up. Two kids were sitting inside of an abandoned car. They were smoking. But the cop asked the kids, what were you guys doing? Nothing, we weren't doing anything. Cop says, I'm gonna ask you guys again, what were you guys doing? They smelt like weed, you know, but kept asking again, what are you doing? Kid said nothing. So the cops pulled him in, put handcuffs on him, put him inside the thing. One of the two kids were explaining to us they were seniors in high school. One of them saying, I'm on my way to college, so on and so forth. But they continued to lie about the fact that they were smoking, were put in, were processed. Later on that night, same night, we get a call from one of the affluent areas of Baltimore about noise, about, you know, a party going on. Music's too loud, et cetera. The cops go and they knock on the door, open up the door. Kids, you know, kids come to the door, 17 years old, 18 years old. No doubt in my mind there was alcohol. No doubt in my mind there was whatever else was going on inside that house. They explained to the officers, we're really sorry, we'll make sure we turn the music down. The officer says, great, thanks. Ended up leaving, going back to their car. They turned the music down and went on for their business, even though there would have been a paddy wagon full of kids if they would have actually searched that place. So the disparities don't just exist in this, in the sentencing, but actually it actually exists from even the ground level for the fact that who gets picked up and who doesn't get picked up, who gets arrested and who doesn't get arrested. One way that we can address that, quite honestly, is making sure that we have people, not just in the criminal justice system, but also within the education system, people who have sympathies towards those who there, you know, there needs to be some form of sympathy put towards. Making sure that we have more African-Americans, particularly African-American males, inside the classroom as teachers, inside the classroom as principals. Making sure that we have more African-Americans who are part of the police force. Making sure that this is taught not just as some prerequisite, but actually something that it becomes very real. Because this is not simply just about, you know, who gets locked up and who doesn't get locked up. There are real economic consequences to the size and to the scope of our criminal justice system, and there are real social consequences to our criminal justice system. Sorry, that's on the criminal justice system side. On the leadership side, one thing I think is very important, and I promise I will try to keep it short, but one thing I think is very important in this larger conversation is making sure that we have people who have a sense of, if not empathy, but sympathy towards the issues that are faced by the others in our society. You know, I actually had a long debate with my publisher about the title of this book. I hated the other Wes Moore for a whole collection of reasons. And I had like five of the names that I liked more, and we battled on this for like seriously about 3 weeks, every day for 3 weeks. Finally, they pushed me over because they said, you know, one thing you have to understand about this title is you're right, this book is not about you and this book is not about him, because my argument was this is a societal conversation. The problem is that you're missing the point. The problem is the name Wes Moore is irrelevant. There are Wes Moores in every community of our country. The most important part about that title is the other. The fact that our society is full of others, people we walk by every day, we don't think about, we don't acknowledge, and we never once think to actually peel the onion back, to actually identify and dissect their life a little bit to help us to understand the decisions that are being made. Being able to have leaders in position that can act, that are willing to dissect these issues some, who are willing to actually peel the onion back, who are willing to, you know, better appreciate the fact that, you know, our society is going to be known by not just not the haves, but it's really our treatment of the have-nots. That is how our society will be defined. That is how our society will be identified. How we bring forth those leaders, and again, not just in governmental positions, but in positions of all stripes in this country, really will help determine where policy is advocated to move towards, where dollars are actually allocated to move towards, and really have to help to identify a more just society. But I think, unfortunately, we have a lot of people who don't fully quite understand the notion, who don't fully quite understand the stories, and therefore can make decisions without the others being in full consideration of those stories.
I'm going to ask you to hold on a minute because actually I think you might want to talk about that, like what it takes to move the conversation forward. And I'm going to ask the other two gentlemen to finish their comments. Paul, do you want to come forward now? And then, Mr. Scott, you can be our cleanup hitter. How's that? Okay. So Paul Butler is an associate dean and professor of law at George Washington University Law School. He's the author of Let's Get Free, A Hip-Hop Theory of Justice.
And a quick question about ways that your work might be interpreted or misinterpreted. So President Obama is famous for going to African-American audiences and scolding them for sending their kids to Popeyes for dinner and not helping them with their homework and having them watch too much TV. So the problem is values. He likes to talk about that. He doesn't talk so much about discrimination and about racism. But there's a way that your story kind of maps onto that dialogue, that, you know, the problem with the other Westmore is kind of about values and not doing the right thing. And you did the right thing. So discrimination, white supremacy, that's not really the issue. The issue is that you had better values and a strong mother. and if only Wes Moore had a mother like you, that's the way to solve the problem, getting his mother to be more like your mother as opposed to working to end white supremacy. One possible interpretation slash misinterpretation. The other is, especially in your conversation with Michelle, it seems like your story is almost as much about gender as it is about race. And when we have this dialogue about black men as this endangered species, then race justice problems become black male problems. And black women tend to get left out. And so when your comment about, well, for boys want to be leaders. It's important to get them in positions where they can be leaders. Well, I think girls want to be leaders too. They at least want to have the opportunity to get to be leaders. So to the extent you talk so much about gender, what about the concern that black women get left out?
Great points, and thank you. And one thing I want to say, I do actually want to push back a little bit on the idea, well, if Wes just had a better mother. Because I don't think it's that easy to say, well, if Wes just had a better mother, things would have worked out better for Wes. Wes has a mother who loves her children deeply. Wes has a mother who loves her children passionately. Wes also had a mother who was working multiple jobs in order to try to provide for her family. And so there are a lot of other situations, much past, you know, this past a situation of will or want that really hindered the path of both Wes and Tony. And for many cases, and I think Wes's mother is actually emblematic of a lot of other mothers, particularly mothers or single fathers who are raising kids on their own. It's not that they don't care. It's that they don't know. And there are a lot of issues for a lot of mothers where, you know, there's a lot of things, like we talk about, for example, the early childhood learning thing. Helping parents to understand why it's important to start reading to your child as early as when that child is in utero. Helping parents to understand why it's important that when you're speaking to your child, goo-goo noises and ooh, that's not helping that child develop a vocabulary. When we're describing things like, you know, what's happening outside, that you say things to your child, not that that's look at the sky, but that's the blue sky, or look at the white cloud, or look at the black, you know, carpet. So they're actually picking up words that help them go to school. So that's one thing I push on the idea of if Wes had my mother, that things would be perfect. And I love my mom. I love my mama. But I know it's much more complicated than that. On this idea of gender, you're spot on. And in no way was I trying to say boys want to be leaders, girls want to be followers, or anything like that. But I do know that when in this situation you had two kids, and again, it's not different from a lot of situations, but you had two kids who were really searching for that sense of belonging and really searching for that sense of leadership. And so the question then becomes, where were they getting it from? I do think it says something about a larger question about our society, though. I do think that we address this, the phasing of girls going into womanhood differently than the way we address boys going into manhood. For this reason, and actually I think this is almost even past race, but when we see girls, when we see boys, the question is, oh, go out there and play. Go out there, don't, you know, fight back, you know, don't let them push you around, so on and so forth. With this girl, it's like, oh, you know, be careful, why don't you stay inside? You know, stay inside, work on, you know. So you have girls who are inside. They're working on, you know, they're writing, they're reading. I even saw it quite honestly with, you know, what happened with my sisters and I. We had very different instructions than my mother. I was always allowed to stay out longer. I had a longer leash in many ways than my sisters did, and I think in many ways that's societal. And when you think about, for example, where we're going in the 21st century. When you think about the fastest growing jobs in the 21st century, the fastest growing jobs in the 21st century are, you know, are things in the, you know, in home healthcare, are things in the teaching profession. These are all this. Exactly, I heard that. That's right. But the prison system. But these are jobs in many cases that or nursing, you don't hear any boys talking about how they want to be nurses. If you talk to a young boy and they say, I want to be a nurse, people look at them sideways, like, a nurse? Don't you mean a doctor? No, a nurse. When you look at the fact that nursing is one of the fastest growing professions inside this country. And so I actually think we're doing boys a disservice by the way we're actually trying to prepare them for what it takes to succeed inside a society, particularly when you look at where the evolution of the 21st century society is going, and particularly the evolution of 21st century employment is going. You know, the fact that girls are actually getting much better, the fact that we have more women PhDs now than men, the fact that we have more women graduating than men, the fact, you know, all these are technical skills that we're doing a much better job of training and preparing women for than we are with our young boys.
Also, Hillary, do you want to step up and have? Because while you're stepping up, I'll just say I also wonder what difference would it have made if she could have supported her family with one job. Okay, and he could have supported his family with a job as opposed to cooking up. You know, crack. That's Hillary Shelton is the NAACP Washington Bureau Director and Senior Vice President for Advocacy. You have a question or a comment?
Well, just a couple of comments first. It's good to see you again, brother. It's fantastic to tell the story. But the thing that excites me the most about the kind of conversation we're having right now is how your story prompts us to have a discussion about the realities and the paradigms in which we're living in, and really the two parallel tracks, but the two so diverging tracks that we see with the other West, more so to speak. I really appreciate that it raises a number of issues. I want to kind of throw some of these themes out and see how they kind of relate to us in other ways. It is the backdrop, and I guess my personal experiences as well, growing up in St. Louis, Missouri, at a time when St. Louis was split north and south. If you were African-American, there was a 99.9% chance you lived on the north side of the city. If you were white, there was a 99% chance you lived on the south side of the city. But with all that, there was always the issue of what the realities, the paradigms, the expectations in many ways. So when you talked about what happened in your life and the mistakes that were made along the way, the support network that you had that worked for you, even when you didn't necessarily want it to work for you. When I heard you talk about the many times you got returned to that military academy, even as you tried to flee, your choice was to go. The structural choice and the policy decisions made by your mama and others were that you would stay and finish. And it really took that kind of structure, in my opinion, to help make that happen for you, even at a time when you weren't sure that's what you wanted to see happen. It's those kind of things that are built into the structures, I think, in our society that we don't get enough of. Because what ends up happening is we have a society that talks about personal responsibility. That becomes a catchphrase for anything that goes wrong. Well, you have a personal responsibility to address these things in a way that's consistent with the values of our nation, whatever those might very well be. But when, as you raise, not just in the book but tonight, that the plan for someone's third grade level based on their reading test scores is one that would determine whether indeed we'd allow you to continue to go forward, our plan for that jail cell that we know you're going to go into. Again, the reality of the paradigm is that we expect you to fail. And we're going to make that decision at the third grade level. We have a plan for you. But it's amazing when we think about that and the realities of kind of the system that was put in place for you, knowing that there could be something better, even as you failed along the way. You could very well determine that your failure was when you left that academy the first time. He ran away. He did not want to participate in the program that was laid out for him and whatnot. You failed. But they grabbed you and brought you back and said, no, not yet. Brother, we're here and you're going to do this. Your decision was a little bit different than the decision that was made for you, but that decision was created by a society that actually planned for your success. But very well, the other Wes Moore was quite different. There was not that planning for the success. There was that exception of the failure and planning to actually warehouse them as a result of that failure. We would argue, and I'm glad Bobby Scott's going to follow me because it's always dangerous for me to try to follow Bobby Scott. But not only that, because some of the things that we talk about in his position as at one time the chairman of the crime subcommittee of the House Judiciary Committee, as we look at the challenges with prisoners in our society and crime and criminal justice, is that the system seems to plan to warehouse us. But we continue to move to try to address those issues anyway. That's why I'm happy about the dialogue that happens around the comparison of these two stories. When I thought about the things you said about your uncle, and I remember very well experiencing some similar things when I was growing up in St. Louis. My parents were from the Deep South. The challenges of segregation were very much with us. The expectation that African Americans were going to end up in jail were very much with us. And maybe one of the reasons my daddy was so hard on us and that my behind is as hard as it is today. But that being said, again, there was that plan for my success and that advocacy that happened with my parents, trying to find that way to make sure that we were going to be successful as well. So I guess that pivotal moment for me was when I was getting ready to graduate from high school. And I'm assuming everybody's going to do what I'm going to do because we lived in the same neighborhoods, we played together, we attended the same classes. I'm asking my friends, well, what college are you going to? Assuming everybody was going to college. And the response I got was shocking to me in many ways, and I can't tell you the kind of mud I felt like I had on my face when my friends would say to me, don't know, no plan. in essence, this society had not planned for me to be successful, to be even be able to make the right choices and have the right options. And that's what I looked at. I thought about real choices in our society. We talk about being able to have real choices, but real choices require real options. And the real options aren't there for too many of us. And you point that out in a way I thought was very, very helpful. You talked about how when you spoke to your uncle about that change issue, you came home and got into a fight because they looked at you, and I remember that very well in some of my experiences as well. Your friends look at you, and the term they would use back in St. Louis was, you think you something. You know, that's the terminology that's played out. They look at you, and you feel like you're successful, you're feeling good about yourself, and you've done well in school for that semester, and you're back at home. You think you're something. Well, yeah, but what's the problem in that and whatnot? Well, I think the problem is, as you laid out, you continue to grow. But your experiences are ones of exposure. You went away to a military academy, you had more exposure. You were able to see what was going on in the world, since you had some other options. It wasn't limited to what was happening in your community. It was very well, much, much broader, much more vast than that. You had a plan to continue to try to see what was going on, not necessarily knowing what you were going to end up doing, but knowing that you had some options that would move you forward. So finally, I just want to leave this point as we discuss those options. And that is that even today, and I guess is my friend Bobby Scott's going to pick up on some of these themes as well, is that the resources that are actually required are oftentimes those that are argued as being most problematic in our society. The struggle we have on Capitol Hill oftentimes is we can't afford to pay for that increase to the Pell Grant program. We can't afford to pay for that necessary money needed for Title I programs in schools that don't have the resources to be able to, we don't have that money. But then we turn around and look at the money they are spending, again, for the other Wes Moore. My guess is your scholarship to the military academy was probably less expensive than the scholarships in that other Wes Moore to the Penal Academy. So indeed, I think those options, those the realities are there. So I just want to say I'm thankful that you're telling your story, because I think that hopefully we'll begin to realize and think about a new paradigm in our society. When we realize we've got to put the real choices and options out there for folks. And as we talk about issues of personal responsibility means you have that responsibility to take advantage of what's in front of you, what the options that you have. We have to make sure those real options are there. So I just want to thank you for that, and no questions, but thank you.
Sure. Sure.
Thank you.
Which other people?
Thank you. Okay. And just very quick, you made an incredibly important point. First of all, the fact that we will spend over $75,000 a year to incarcerate Wes every year, and if he gets sick, that number goes up. If we need more guards, that number goes up, et cetera. So the fact that we'll spend millions of dollars to incarcerate him for the rest of our life. Now, again, in no way am I making any excuses for what happened. In no way. But these are real. And these are real numbers that we're talking about where do we find the money to do this. But, you know, it's funny that I tell you last summer, very quick, Nick Kristof did an op-ed about the book last summer, and he basically wrote how this book was a great examination of race and poverty and how it reflects itself, how it manifests itself in our society. And literally 2 or 3 weeks later, Michael Gerson, who was former speechwriter for President Bush, wrote an op-ed about he really enjoyed this book because it was about, you know, personal responsibility and the ability for people to step up. And I found that so fascinating because these two people agree on pretty much nothing, right? And had two very different takeaways from the story. And I remember someone asking about that, and they said, so what do you think? I said, well, the truth is both of them are right in some way. You cannot talk about responsibility and underestimate the importance of personal responsibility, that people have to make decisions based on what they have around them. However, you cannot talk about personal decisions without understanding societal context to these decisions. And so it's a very intricate marriage, as you pointed out, to this as the how that responsibility lies, and society cannot just absolve itself of the decisions that people make. There are contexts to these decisions, and that has to be understood and really digested by society.
I'm not sure how much time we're going to have for questions from the audience, but I know, Congressman Scott, we'd love to hear from you if you have some thoughts that you'd like to share. Do you want to come up? Congressman Bobby Scott represents the 3rd District of Virginia. He serves on the Judiciary Committee, where, miracle of miracles, you actually managed to get some legislation out today. You'll have to tell us how that happened. And the Education and Workforce Committee. And we'd love to hear what you have to say, and I also have a question for you.
Good. Well, thank you. Thank you very much, and it's certainly a pleasure to be here. And Wes, I want to thank you for telling your story, because you have shown that two people, same neighborhood, can end up different, and in kind of point out where the little points were that made such a difference. The other Wes's mother goes to college and then gets kicked out because the policy has changed, and that was a life change, because if she had gone to college, she would have taken the other Wes in that direction. We have choices to make, and one of the things that I tell in criminal justice, we really have basic choices. We can play politics or we can reduce crime. We know how to do it, and you've kind of alluded to it. If you get people locked into a prevention strategy that puts them on a trajectory, one way, they'll go that way. And another way, we're in right now the cradle to prison pipeline. One-third of black boys born today can expect to serve time in prison. And we know if we had provided the teen pregnancy prevention, the prenatal care, the nurse visits early on, their early childhood education, make sure they read by the third grade, after-school programs, and instead of a cradle to prison, a cradle to college, a cradle to the workforce, that you'll get different results. The choice is, that's the substantive choice, how you reduce crime. The political choice is codify all the slogans and sound bites and run up, do nothing about crime, but you do run up the incarceration rate. We lock up a higher portion of our population than any country on earth by far. In most countries, it's 50 to 200. In the United States, it's 700 per 100,000, which is an interesting number because the Pew Research Center says anything over 500 is actually counterproductive. You're injecting more social pathology into a community than you're bringing out if you're anywhere over 500. Black community, it's 2,200. 10 states lock up blacks at the rate of 4,000 per 100,000. Now, that's not free. That is a disgraceful abuse of resources when you're running up an incarceration rate of 4,000 per 100,000 when anything over 500 per 100,000 is actually counterproductive. And if you just do the back of the envelope arithmetic at one third of the 30% of the population, children, and to put all that extra incarceration money at 30,000 or more a year and then aim it at the one third of the children that are at risk, the number that you are wasting is $10,000 per child every year in counterproductive incarceration. And so when you have a choice of the early childhood education and the after-school programs and the college access, you can afford it because you're wasting all of that money in counterproductive incarceration. And with one-third of the young boys on the way to prison, somebody just talked about the expectation that you're going to prison. That has a real devastating effect on a child's future when the expectation is prison and not college. When the expectation is college, you kind of go in that direction. Expectation is prison. The criminal justice system has no deterrent effect because everybody's going anyway. Everybody's got a criminal record. Having a criminal record isn't anything to be deterred about. And I think your story, we can do this. Somebody mentioned a bunch of nerds around here. I'm one. I can talk numbers all day. But your story helps put the real meat to the situation, because you have shown if you set children off on the right trajectory, they can go in that direction. And if you don't, you end up with the other Wes Moore. And we end up spending $1 million on him in prison and not nearly that much on you for military academy, college, and everything that you've been able to achieve. One of the challenges we have is how we get public policymakers to make the right choice. Because the politics is, you can vote for, if you do the adult crime, you do the adult time. That's a little rhyme that everybody, that's been studied often, and every conclusion is, if you codify that soundbite, you'll increase the crime rate and waste money. Discriminate against minorities, endanger the children. I mean, nothing good happens when you increase the number of children tried as adults, but it runs 80% in the polls. And so politicians adopt that policy. How do we get, and when they vote for it, I vote against it, and the media calls me why did you vote against it? And I say, because it's stupid, it'll increase crime. And they say, oh, okay. They don't call the others. Why did you vote for a proposal that will increase the crime rate, crimes will be more violent, committed sooner, endanger the children, and discriminate against minorities? Why did you vote for that? They never have to answer that question. How do we change the public policy so that we can take the intelligent approach that reduces crime, saves money, and produces a better America, rather than what we're doing now with the cradle of prison pipeline?
Great question.
I was going to ask you that question, though. When you say that to your colleagues, when you say that to your colleagues, what do they say? I mean, presumably you're not the only person in the Congress who can do math. But when you say that to your colleagues, you can say this is counterproductive, it's too expensive, it doesn't work. Okay, what do they say?
Well, you have to listen to what people are listening to. Try more juveniles as adults will increase the crime rate, crimes more likely to be committed sooner, more violent, discriminate against minorities, endanger the children, and run 70 to 80% in the polls. To a lot of my colleagues, all they heard was 70 to 80% in the polls. And why in the world, if you're trying to get elected, would you start off on the short end of a 70-30 split, or an 80-20 split? Why, just take the fat side of that equation, and then go on to health care, or get out of Iraq, or whatever other issue you want to talk about. What sense does it make to take the short end of the stick? What we need to do is kind of change the arithmetic a little bit so that they are questioned, and they have to answer. I've told people that if you had a candidate that had on his brochure supports the adult time for adult crimes, they had a couple of questions in meetings like this. Excuse me, we all know that's going to increase the crime rate. Are you that stupid, or do you think we're that stupid? A couple of questions like that, and the next printing of the brochure will have a blank space where that was. Because the only reason they do it is crass politics. Their pollster told them it'd help them get elected. Now, when it stops helping them get elected, they'll stop being stupid. And I guess the question is, how can we engage the debates? Numbers and whatnot are helpful, but stories like this really help, because they humanize the situation and said, if you do this, you'll get one Wes Moore, and if you go the other way, you'll get the other Wes Moore. Furthermore, this Wes Moore is cheaper to produce.
You hear that? You're cheaper to produce. Thank you, Congressman Scott. I'm going to ask you to... There is a, Sam Fullwood's going to come back and tell us about the rest of the evening, but before we do, for those who are not able to come to the reception, will you have a closing thought for us? And then I think you're going to sign some books. Yes. Sam's going to tell us about the rest of the evening, but for those who are not able to participate in the rest of the evening, will you give us a final thought?
Of course, yeah, and thank you. And if I can make a quick thought, and that'll lead into my final thought, because you were spot on. I remember having a conversation with my publisher about the idea, because at first I was like, well, if I want to do this, maybe I can, you know, do a kind of like a 10-step, and here are some things that that parents should think about, or society should think about, and da da da. And he said something to me, a guy named Chris Jackson said to me, which was spot on. He said, listen, I'm gonna be honest with you, that sounds interesting, but no one wants to read a book about parenting from a 30-year-old with no kids. And so he was like, the way you should really have them understand this is just tell the stories. And people will understand what the difference is between our attention or our apathy. And I think you hit the nail on the head, because it's much easier. That quote break sounds great. Soft on crime, don't vote for them. Tough on crime, vote for me. Or whatever, without ever digging into what that really means. I think the ability to engage on that, the interest to gauge on that that you have, and the ability to help people understand what those consequences are, not simply by the numbers, because you're right, that can become mind-numbing for people, but by helping them, by illustrating what does it mean that we are essentially throwing, what does it mean to have a conversation about the future of this country when only a portion of the country is a part of that conversation? And what does it mean to have a conversation about the long-term stability of our country when only a portion of this country is even being thought about in that larger conversation? So I think you hit it spot on. And for the closing idea, I remember having a conversation once with Wes, and we were talking about Baltimore. And I asked him, I said, so do you think that we're products of our environment? And he looked back at me and he said, actually, I think we're products of our expectations. which I thought was an incredibly insightful and important point of that we're not products of our environments, we're products of our expectations. But now where that becomes very important in terms of our larger society is the expectations that we have of ourselves aren't born from nowhere. You know, if we firmly believe, if we look at a young person, they said that person, they'll finish high school, they'll go on to college, they'll become a great father and husband or a great mother and wife, and they'll be productive to our society. And that's generally, and we put those tools in place for them to do it. Then that's generally, as you said, what kids will do. But if we look at that kid or the neighborhood that kid lives in and said they probably won't finish, they'll probably end up in the juvenile justice system, they'll probably eventually end up in the adult prison system. Then kids have a funny way of making that happen as well. And so this country is full of self-fulfilling prophecies, full of them. And so the question then becomes, as Wes correctly said, how do we make sure that we become products of our expectations, and how do we make sure that we have the correct expectations in place? Then those expectations actually end up becoming something that we, as a society, we all can all be proud of.
On behalf of the American Constitution Society for Law and Policy, Open Society Foundations, and Progress 2050 at the Center for American Progress, I have two things to say. Thank you.